really short question.
Okay.
Ready?
Yeah.
Who is Carmen?
Me.
Short answer.
Madame Bovary, c'est moi. Who is she? I think if we could answer that quickly, there would be no opera. She's like Don Giovanni, one of those very few people who think and who are think that they can be outside society. The people who actually resent the social contract, which makes you give up most of your freedom. Because, you know, you can't just get up at 2 o'clock in the morning and set off fireworks in your garden because you have neighbors, you know. There's that kind of thing, that kind of life that goes into, if you follow its logic, to the criminal fringes of society. And not Giovanni, but Carmen lives in the criminal fringes of society. One of the problems with the opera, I always say, and with most operas, is that we've somehow in the past few decades cleaned them up. Therefore, you as an audience don't engage because you look at this woman with red hair and she's dressed like you saw in that first Carmen coming in, right? And that's not a gypsy, that's a movie star. And the audience somehow, consciously or subconsciously, begins not to believe the story. And the minute they don't believe this is a gypsy, this is very bad news, this is a gang girl, she lives with a gang. Of not with, you know, Robin Hood's merry men, but with cutthroats, people who kill for money and who steal and who go over the border with weapons. Today would be the border, I guess, in Arizona where the drugs are going back and forth. Today she would be tattooed from head to toe and pierced. She's very bad news. But you, instead of that, you see, if you read the novella, you get it right away. It's right there. But our production practices, I don't know if it's in a effort to attract the right audiences, not to scandalize people too much. They scandalized. I mean, that when this opera opened, the people knew what they were watching, and they knew gypsies, and yeah, they were absolutely horrified. This is not only a woman who's... again, a gypsy and a criminal, she also makes her living in the oldest profession in the world. So you look at all this and you don't quite believe it and you begin to disengage. Then that beautiful music comes up, and instead of opening the gates to the story, as it, every time I hear it and I've grown up with it, the hair in the back of my head stands up. It's so incredible. The music acts as a buffer, and all of a sudden we find ourselves watching this story, which is brutal, scary, violent, very, very sexy, but we're watching it through a filter of prettiness that lies about the story, and the audience kind of knows, well, the tunes are great, but I don't quite buy what's happening there, but they don't actually say that. There's all operas like that. Unbelievable. And they begin to separate, and that's why I believe that most operas today don't have the pow that they should have, most of them, depending on the story, obviously. This one certainly should have a huge, you know, what I call a huge sucker punch. And because we have cleaned it up very much. That's not what we're intending to do. So we're gonna take it right back to the novella and to who these people are supposed to be. And, you know, it becomes very interesting and very, very scary. It's a woman in, again, a woman who lives on the fringes of society, criminal, who basically picks up a man in the middle of a problem, who becomes her stalker and who kills her at the end. Y'all watch HLN? Every day. Only it's with Bizet's music. But that's what happens in Carmen, and that's who she is.